it's my pleasure to introduce Ramesh Narayan from Harvard, who's going to tell us about black holes and latent singularities.
Thank you. So when Yao invited me to give this talk, I was really reluctant because, you know, my day job is as an astrophysicist, astronomer, and I didn't know what to tell mathematicians that would be of interest to you. Though, you know, Yao said, it doesn't matter, we listen to anything, but still, I decided instead, I won't talk about what I normally work on. So mostly this is kind of like a hobby, things that I do on the side, which has become more interesting now that I'm part of the BHI upstairs, the Black Hole Initiative. You know, we are beginning to think more about black holes and what they mean, are they real, are there singularities and things like that. So this is going to be kind of a bit of a wandering talk. I'm going to spend maybe a third at most on the black hole part of this talk. A larger fraction will be just on general concepts, on singularities and naked singularities in particular. And right at the end, I want to say a little bit about what these things might mean for astronomy in terms of actual observations. You shouldn't take anything too seriously because they're all going to be very model calculations, but nevertheless, I believe they are interesting. Okay, so let's start with the black holes. So as you all know, for a long time, nobody thought these things were real. It's great, you find a solution from Einstein's equations, but people thought it's too weird, it cannot be real. Until astronomers found that they are real, and not just real, they're extremely common in the universe. Right, so now we know that there is a supermassive black hole, 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 10 solar masses, in the nucleus of every galaxy. And each galaxy, in addition, has got enormous numbers, more than 10 to the 7 small black holes, in the mass range, maybe 5 to 30, perhaps even a bit more, now that we know from light. So how do we see these guys? They radiate. Generally, these black holes accrete gas. The gas comes in, it goes around the black hole in some kind of an accretion disk. And as the gas flows in, it releases all this potential energy. Some of it is converted to heat, and it comes out as radiation. We observe these things. So for instance, this is the first class that was discovered, the quasars, long time ago, more than 50 years ago, 60 years ago. So you know, these, as I said, there are these big black holes, 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 10, in most galaxies, and we see these very bright sources in a good fraction of those. Other galaxies still have the same black hole, but they'll be dimmer, just because they probably have less gas flowing into the center. Many of these systems also produce jets, outflows with relativistic speeds. I'm not going to say anything about that. This is the second class. These are the stellar mass black holes, 5 to 30, and solar masses that are 10 to the 7 in the galaxy or more. Some small fraction of them happen to be in binary systems. So that's the black hole, this is some companion star. And once again, what you have is gas accretion. The moment you drop gas on a black hole, it starts becoming very bright, and these guys become bright in X-rays, and they are detected through X-ray observatories. Okay, so I'll say a little bit about these guys. This is a new category, new in the sense of observational astrophysics. These are so-called TDEs, or tidal disruption events. What you have is a black hole similar to this one, sitting somewhere in the nucleus of a galaxy, and every once in a while, some star happens to come very close to the black hole. You know, stars are just floating around, may come very close. And when it comes very close, close enough, the tidal pull of the black hole can rip the star apart. So what happens is the star is destroyed, it becomes this long plume of material, and some fraction of this material comes back and accumulates around the black hole. Then it becomes just an accretion disk like this. Gas flows in, we see radiation, we see X-rays, we see radio, we may see a jet. So a lot of this phenomenology is seen here, but these are transients. You'll have a black hole that's doing nothing, and then one day suddenly it heats up a star, it becomes very bright for months, and then it disappears. So these are interesting, I'm going to say something about them as I go along. There's one more category of object that we believe involves a black hole. These are gamma ray bursts. I won't say more about that. Okay. So now let's ask, why do we think they are black holes? For astronomers, the argument is very simple. We say a black hole is any object that is relativistic, so it must be very compact, so that the potential energy at the surface is a reasonable fraction of c squared, or equivalently, the radius should be less than a few times gm over c squared. That's one condition. Second condition is it should be more massive than a neutron star, because a neutron star is a relativistic object, and it's not a black hole, it has a surface and all that. But we know that a neutron star has some mass limit, say maximum three solid masses. So if you're above three solid masses, you're in business. So in fact, this is how we identified all of these objects with black holes. They're all too massive to be neutron stars. They're clearly compact. Done. Okay. Now, a mathematician wouldn't accept this, I think, as a definition of a black hole. Right? This is a very practical definition. The mathematician's definition, I think, is the physicist's definition, certainly is that there should be an event horizon. This is this one-way membrane, as we all know. A virtual surface around this compact object. Things can fall in, nothing can get down. It's a one-way street. And at least in the simplest models, as you know, the radius of the surface is this Schwarzschild radius, 2gm over c squared. Now, inside this horizon, there is a singularity. You're pretty confident about that. I'll come to the singularity later. Right now, my story is on the event horizon. So, here's the question. We've got these, you know, zillions of black holes, and I'll call them black hole candidates, that have been found by astronomers. How do we know they're really black holes? Certainly, they're too massive to be neutron stars, but, you know, like we heard in the colloquium yesterday, you know, you can have all sorts of crazy objects with surfaces, crazy theories. Gravastar, I don't know what your model is called, but whatever it is, yeah. there are many models, and maybe they're compact but don't have a horizon. So here is a question that you can ask. How about using observations, astronomical observations, to check whether there's an horizon or not? Okay? This would be qualitative, as you will see. It's not going to be precise, but it could be a deep test. So this is something that I've been doing now off and on for more than 20 years. And the approach that we have been taking is, all of these black holes that we observe, they all have material falling in, right? Typically, you have an accretion disk. Material goes around, it comes down, and then presumably disappears in the center. Since this material is going in and it's radiating, and when the material comes to the center, it certainly knows. Presumably, it knows. If it had a brain, it will know whether it's a horizon or a surface. And if it uses that brain to send us some signals, you know, we should hope that our observations should tell us whether the gas actually met a horizon or a surface. Now, the first thing I'm going to say, and I won't discuss in any detail, okay, just I'm going to show one picture and then move on, is based on these X-ray binaries. So these are X-ray binaries. As I said, the black hole candidates are 5 to 20 solar mass or 30 solar mass objects with a companion star. Now, it turns out there are a huge number of neutron star binaries also in the galaxy. Same picture, only difference is instead of a black hole, you have a neutron star. The neutron star we know has a surface. So the trick here is to take these two samples, black hole X-ray binaries, neutron star X-ray binaries, try to figure out if there is some observational distinction which will show that the black holes are different from the neutron stars, and then can we interpret that difference as the difference between horizon and surface. So that's in fact where I started this game. This was in 1997. So this was this first paper we wrote in 97, three of us, myself, Mike Garcia, and Jeff McClintock, where we looked at some available X-ray data, and I won't go into any of the astronomical jargon, because this will be confusing for at least some members of the audience. Basically, we had a theory. The theory said, under such and such conditions, the black hole should be much, much dimmer than the neutron star. The idea being, Black hole just swallows stuff, it goes in and it disappears. But if there's a surface, stuff will fall on the surface, it will radiate. We should see that extra radiation. And under the right conditions, the difference can be orders of magnitude. Right? This is what came out of the model. So we went and looked at the data. And in 97, we didn't have all this data. We had about 4 points in this diagram. I think, I remember that was one. Okay, so here let me explain. All the black dots are objects that we call black hole candidates. Right? They are too massive to be neutron stars. All the open circles are objects that we know are neutron stars based on other criteria. So we had 2 of these guys and I think 2 of those guys, and there was a difference in luminosity between them. So we said, look, this is at least consistent. Can we do better? Can we get more data? And that's what happened over the years, and by 2003 we kind of finished our job. And this was the full sample we had as of that time. These are all the black holes, these are all the neutron stars. This is a log scale, okay? So this is nice, full 2-3 orders of magnitude difference. Little worry, it should have been even more, but you know, we'll take 3 orders of magnitude. That's really quite a large difference, and it seems to be consistent with these guys having horizons, just swallowing stuff, these guys accreting material on the surface and radiating. Now, after I haven't looked at this since 2003, basically. I've heard about this paper by Reynolds and Miller. They say they got a black hole, which happens to sit in the neutron star band. I haven't looked at it since then. Maybe there are other counterexamples by now. Still, I think a pretty strong signal. Okay, so I won't say more about this. I want to talk about another thing which we did just last year, which is easier to explain, so that you know people can follow, even those who don't know astronomy. So for this, I'm going to use the TDEs, these tidal disruption events. So remember what I said, there's a black hole, a star comes, gets ripped apart, and then the material kind of comes back, basically, after one round. And then some of that material accumulates, forms an accretion disk, accretes, and you know, this is now, there are probably about a dozen or more of these events that have been detected, and it's anticipated that hundreds, thousands will be seen soon when better surveys come online. So it's a big business, okay? And people try to understand the radiation from the accretion disk. There's a jet, optical, X-rays, radio. That's not my story. Now, the thing is, TDEs are not inevitable. There can be failed TDEs. And the criterion is very simple. If you have a black hole which is more than 10 to the 8 solar masses, then when the star comes, the tidal field is such that it doesn't rip the star apart, the black hole. The star will just fall into the black hole. Okay? The point is that for low mass black holes, a star can be already ripped when it's at that distance, away from the horizon or the ISCO of the supermassive black hole. But if it's more than this 10 to the 8 solar masses, the star has to come inside to be ripped, and by then it's gone through the horizon and disappeared. So that's the point. Very massive black holes will swallow the star whole, will not rip it apart, so you won't get a TDE out of it. And sure enough, all the observed TDEs, as far as we can tell, they are from black holes in this mass range, 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7. Some people argue maybe 7.5, but definitely nothing above. And what is more interesting, these swallowing up events should happen often in the universe. And you can even calculate, I'll show you a big picture, but without going into details. So let's ask, what will happen when a star approaches a greater than 10 to the 8 solar mass black hole? What do we expect to see? So this is the standard picture. If you have a black hole, the star will come, will go through the horizon, disappear, and it'll just vanish. Just get dimmer and disappear. In fact, you won't even know it happened because it doesn't produce any fireworks of any kind. But if this is not a black hole, it had a surface, then what happens? Then what will happen is this air will come, crash against the surface, there will be a luminous splash because all of this kinetic energy and potential energy will be released, the gas will become hot, you will get radiation out of it, you will get a big bright flash from this collision of the star with the surface. You can actually, it's not very hard to calculate or to predict what it should look like. because it's a very simple situation. There are only a few parameters. It's the mass of the star, mass of the black hole, and the surface redshift is important. So what you see finally depends on how much redshift there is from the surface to infinity. We are at infinity. Okay, so that's an important parameter. But given those parameters, you can calculate. In fact, the spectrum is very simple. You should see actually a smooth light curve. It will go up, and it will come down. It will rise fast. It will decline slowly. It will be a pure black body at all times. And you can actually predict what temperature it should have, what luminosity it should have. All that is pretty straightforward to do. Have we seen this? This is the question that this guy, Lou, and his advisor, Pawan Kumar, and I asked. That's really Lou's idea. Very smart guy. And the answer is, already with current data, you can rule out any surface with a sufficiently low redshift. So the redshift is important. So the current limit is, if supermassive black holes had surfaces, and if the surface redshift is below 10 to the 4.4, that's the best estimate, some 3 sigma limit, below 10 to the 4.4, we would have seen these black body light flashes. We have never seen a single one of them. So what this means is, either they're all black holes, or they have surfaces with a redshift greater than 10 to the 4.4. And I think this is what you were saying in your talk also yesterday. All the electromagnetic signals, they are limited by the redshift at some level. If you make the redshift really large, sure, then it's much harder to tell. But this puts already a limit. And with future surveys, examples, LSST, etc., I think you go to 10 to the 6, it gets harder much beyond that. Maybe this redshift does two things. It makes the light curve longer, and it also makes the temperature cooler. So it goes out of the optical and infrared band. It'll come in some band where you cannot make the observations. But it's okay. This is pretty interesting. This is putting a limit on the whole population. I mean, there are zillions of these black holes in the universe. And you're saying all of them must better have redshift greater than 10 to the 4.4, or hopefully soon 10 to the 6. There are many other arguments. You know, they're all in this spirit. If it had a surface, we should have seen something. We haven't seen it. Therefore, either it doesn't have a surface at all, i.e. it's a black hole, or the surface is constrained in some fashion. Very high redshift, non-baryonic, you know, spin properties, etc. I would say at the level of plausible arguments on what the surface might look like, the evidence from astronomy is very strong at this point. There's so many arguments. To escape all of them is really almost impossible. And LIGO is going to just make this stronger and stronger. But of course, you can always invoke some strange physics where the surface has really unusual properties, and you can probably get around all of these arguments by doing those kinds of things. But this is kind of where we are right now in terms of astronomy and black holes and evidence for event horizon. So let me move on to singularity. This is what I really wanted to talk about, and where I know the least, actually. But hopefully we'll start a conversation, and then we can all talk about this. So here is the standard picture that we all draw for a Schwarzschild black hole. So there's the horizon, and right in the middle there is this singularity. All the mass is supposed to be here. It's got infinite curvature, and you know, everything breaks down at that point. So this is something that turns up in GR. So the question is, are these singularities real? And, you know, do they violate some physics? And I'm going to show you, kinds of worries that people have. But the existence of a singularity is pretty much, I think, proved. Because what these singularity theorems by Penrose, Hawking, and others show is, once you have this event horizon or trapped surface, the interior is forced to become singular. That will be, let us say, incomplete geodesics. You know, there are certain strange properties. Though, you know, they cannot tell you what kind of singularity it is. The Schwarzschild singularity is very special. Most other singularities are much stranger. But something very strange will happen, and in fact, physics will break down at some level, because everybody is coming to the center, gravity wins, etc. That's the nature of these theorems. So I'm going to kind of explore you know, what the singularity is all about. And to do that, we'll start with this very classic model, Oppenheimer and Schneider. This is 1939. This is when they first can actually produce a black hole in a model. They didn't call it black hole, I don't know what they called it. But it's basically collapse of material to a singular point. So what they considered was a spherical sphere of gas, uniform density, with gravity, not gas, dust. What that means is there's no pressure. It's just got mass, gravity, and it just collapses by itself. This problem can actually be solved exactly in general relativity. They did it. So all the mass comes down. Everybody collapses and crashes to the center at the same instant. And you form this infinite singular point with infinite density, zero radius, etc. So that's what this diagram is showing. All of these are parts of these different elements of material. A singularity is formed, and then the singularity lives forever in this diagram. We're supposed to think of this as radius and time. A horizon is formed, and the interesting thing is the horizon forms before the singularity. You can trace light rays and geodesics, and you can show that in this model, the horizon first forms here at this point A, and then it grows. This is the standard size, 2gm over c squared here. And if you happen to add more material later, the horizon will expand to the new mass, to the new value of 2. But this is interesting. Singularity is there, but it's only formed after the horizon. Now I'm going to look at this same collapse in what is called the Penrose diagram, which most of you have kind of grown up with it. I suspect there are one or two people who might not have seen this concept before. So I just wanted to, it's just a convenient way of looking at the causal structure of any model or any spacetime. And by causal structure, I just mean who can talk to who can influence who else, and who can be influenced by who else. So let's start with normal Minkowski space. We will suppress two dimensions, two space dimensions. We just consider one space and one time dimension. And we'll use units c equal to 1. So as you know, in this space, light rays will go at 45 degrees. So I'm sitting at a point P, and I shoot a light ray to positive x, it goes like that, negative x, goes like that. And since nothing can go faster than the speed of light, what this means is that this point P, this space-time point P, can only influence points in this future light cone. So that's the only region that is accessible to be influenced or to signals from P. Similarly, this past triangular region is the only region that can send signals to P. So this is the past, that's the future. And in contrast to, you know, Newtonian physics, this is relativity, there are all these other regions which are neither future nor past. So what are they? They're called space-like. I cannot influence them, they cannot influence me. They're independent of me. Okay? Now what Penrose diagram does is, it keeps the structure. That is to say, light rays still go at 45 degrees. So we can still talk about who is the future, who is the past of every point. But other than that, it squeezes and stretches the coordinates in some complicated way, such that infinity is brought down to a finite distance. So this is the same Minkowski space in the Penrose diagram. So this is supposed to be my point P. This is the future, this is the past. These are all space-like displacements. And this is all, the edge of this diagram is all infinity. So this is infinite time, infinite space, null infinity, and all of that stuff. We don't need to know the details. I'm going to use this Penrose diagram, which is standard in this business, and I'm going to show you what Oppenheimer-Schneider collapse of this cloud looks like. This is the Penrose diagram of the collapse of a cloud, uniform density cloud. So the guy collapses in these Penrose coordinates. This is where everybody came together. This is my singularity in this diagram, okay, this thick black line. This is the horizon, r equal to 2m, and then this is infinity, etc., etc. So in this diagram, this is all the material that's collapsing. This is everybody outside the star and outside the horizon. This is inside the horizon, and that is the singularity. Okay. So as you can see, time is going up in this diagram. The singularity is certainly beyond the horizon. So anything to do with the singularity is only, you know, visible or hidden behind the horizon. Outside here, before you cross the horizon, no problem. And this is true for all black hole solutions. The singularities are there, but they're all inside the horizon, safely away from us. But the surprising thing is, this singularity is space-like. Okay? Now if you look at the original Oppenheimer-Schneider picture, you would say, there's a singularity, but it's kind of going along the time axis. And you might almost be tempted to think, when this material is coming in, it will actually see the singularity. You might think that some signal from here might reach you, and you say, oh my God, I'm approaching a singular, an anchored singularity here. In fact, in Schwarzschild, this is not the case. I mean, Oppenheimer-Schneider. This is space-like. If this guy was going to send out any signals, it has to go out here in the future light cone. In fact, there is no space-time there. Space-time stopped here. So this singularity can receive signals, but it cannot emit signals. It's space-like. Okay. So some poor observer who comes in here will get crushed, will never receive a signal from this singularity. So I would call this a very benign singularity. It's a singular thing, okay? You're going to die when you hit here. And when I say die, in fact, time itself stops, right? The geodesic just stops, there is no proper time beyond that point. So it's quite bad, but you don't get signals from here. But this is an exception. Almost all the other singularities have got more structure than this. And they are the ones that I want to focus on. So let me call these to start with as non-space-like singularities. They happen in general relativity. There are two kinds. So called null singularities and time-like singularities. I'll show some pictures as I go along. These are bad news. Because these guys can radiate. They can send signals that people in the space-time can observe. And the bad thing is, if it's a singularity, you don't know how to predict what it will produce. See, in physics, we like to believe that if you know all the initial conditions, you can predict the future of everything. These singularities kill that predictability. They are present in space-time. It means that there are regions of the space-time where you cannot predict what will happen. You can predict what you can do. Your initial conditions will tell you something. But once you go there, there may be this other singularity which is sending signals, and that can send anything. It's unpredictable based on our physics. So people don't like this. So this is why this is such a big deal. People keep on trying to figure out, can we eliminate these singularities? Is there something wrong about them? Why is the theory giving me all this? So anything can flow out of this infinite curvature singularity, and this is bad news. So I, for the purposes of this talk, I'm going to call anything that's not a space-like singularity as a naked singularity. Some people, quibble, but I'm just going to call this naked singularities. They give unpredictable effects. Bad news for physics. And so Penrose actually asked, this is the famous cosmic censorship conjecture, does there exist a cosmic censor who forbids the appearance of naked singularity? Suppose there is some rule in the theory which basically said, no, this will never happen under these conditions, and let us say they are plausible physical conditions, then we are in good shape. You know, you can make these singularities in weird formulations, but any real physical formulation won't have it because of the cosmic censor, assuming it's true. And then, you know, we can feel happy about physics. So this was the conjecture he started with. Still not proven. In fact, it seems less and less likely to be true. But I'll tell you how far people have come. Now, the thing is, there are certainly solutions in GR where regions of space-time receive signals from singularities. In other words, there are solutions in GR with these non-space-like singularities, naked singularities. And here are some of them. These are famous solutions. So other than the Schwarzschild, every other black hole solution has got a naked singularity by this definition. So Reisner-Nordstrom, as you know, is a spherically symmetric black hole with a charge. Kerr black hole is a rotating black hole. Both of these guys have singularities. I'm going to show you Penrose diagrams of these. I won't explain it, but I just want you to admire how horribly complicated it is. Okay? the Schwarzschild black hole's Penrose diagram is very simple. Even the fully extended spacetime, which I'm not going to show, is a nice, simple, compact diagram. You can kind of absorb it fully. This is Rasmussen and Nordstrom. And all I did here is I took Schwarzschild and added a little chart. It could be as little as you want. This is what it is supposed to look like. There are horizons, two of them. There's a regular horizon. There's a, I think it's called the inner horizon. There are multiple copies extending to infinity. There are wormholes. And most importantly, there are these time-like similarities. And if you happen to go to this region, assuming you can do it, you can receive signals from this negative similarity. Curve looks almost the same, even though it's an on-axis symmetric. It's got more structure. Same thing, outer horizon, inner horizon, time-like singularity, wormholes, white holes, next universe, and next universe. You know, it's just fantastic. And all we did was we took that Schwarzschild and just spun it up a little bit, and suddenly it became this, according to the theory. So these solutions exist, and they certainly do have naked singularities, though they're hidden deep inside. Okay, so I'll come to that. You can say, it's okay, I can live with this. It's way out there in the distance. Who cares? Lots of models have been done of self-similar spherical collapse. So you take a spherical cloud with some power law distribution, and then you allow the whole thing to collapse. I haven't studied this literature in detail. Many people have worked on this. I will just leave it for now. But I'm saying that they do produce naked singularities. This is the one I'm going to spend a few minutes describing, more than a few minutes, because it's quite interesting. Because Oppenheimer-Schneider is what we all grow up with when we talk about black holes. And we have to recognize that Oppenheimer-Schneider is a very special model. Of course, it's spherically symmetric, and that's already a problem in the sense it's highly symmetric, and the real situation, who knows? But more than that, it assumes a uniform initial density. That's the reason why everybody fell to the center at the same time. Now you would think, even within the space of spherically symmetric models, a more generic situation would be something other than constant density. There'd probably be some variations in density. In particular, the center, which is the one that you're most interested in, because that's where the singularity forms, the center may either be curved upwards or curved downwards. I'm talking about density versus radius, which will be completely flat, right? That's okay, because it's easy to solve. But slightly more generic is to put a little curvature. The moment you do that, the whole story changes, okay? That nice, beautiful Oppenheimer-Schneider diagram and the Penrose diagram, all that will change. This guy, which I'm not going to talk about, density minimum. So if I have less density in the middle, and it increases and reaches some maximum at the edge. If I collapse this guy, you get so-called shell crossing. Basically, the outer regions are falling faster than the inner regions, and they try to cross each other. And where they cross, we get effectively shocks that we talked about in astrophysics. But there's no pressure here. We just get infinite densities, crazy curvature blow up, and things like that. As far as I know, but somebody should correct me, as far as I know, these shell crossings are relatively mild singularities. I think geodesics can go through them, so they don't, you know, they don't kill space-time. It's just that they give you some local mild infinities. This is the guy I want to talk about, which is also, I think, a much more physical condition. They start with a uniform, non-uniform cloud. I put more density in the middle and less density on the outside. Some quadratic variation. In fact, you can even make it simpler. Assume that you have a cloud which goes from some central density to zero at the boundary. Completely natural model, right? What will this guy do? Let me show you. This guy will also produce a singularity, just like the original Oppenheimer-Schneider. I have learned about this model from Joshi and Vivedi. 93. I think it's related to Christodoulou's work from 84, but I haven't read Christodoulou. It's a bit tough for me, okay? All these lemmas and theorems and proofs a little bit too much. But here's the physical picture. This guy, with more density in the middle, it does what you would expect. the center collapses first, and then the outer regions come in later, instead of everybody coming together. So the center will first collapse and form a singularity, then more material is being added. Horizon still forms before the singularity, so that's a good thing. But this particular singularity now is a naked singularity. Okay? So as soon as it forms, it is, for a short period of time, naked. Then it becomes a normal Schwarzschild-like singularity. It's not at all obvious from a diagram like this. This is what the Penrose diagram looks like for this problem. Okay? So previously what I had was, this was time going up, and it just hit the space-like singularity, it was horizontal. Now what happens is, this original horizontal singularity grows a little extra notch. This is a null singularity, it's going at 45 degrees angle. So this is a naked singularity, it is null. So the tip of the singularity has a segment like this, and then it becomes space-like, and here it just looks like normal Schwarzschild. Horizon is here. So all this nonsense is happening well behind the horizon. So in that sense, it is safe. But what does this naked singularity mean? What it means is that this little point here can radiate. It can send out signals. They can't escape the horizon. They will go and then they fall back on the singularity. But this region of space-time can actually, in principle, receive signals from the naked singularity. And if the naked singularity does some crazy, say, quantum gravity or whatever, you will actually get experimental information on quantum gravity if you're sitting around here. In the Penrose diagram, that is this region. So imagine some observer who crosses the horizon and happens to wander into this shaded region. This observer is not yet fallen into the singularity of the black hole, but can receive signals from the naked singularity. So this is you know, there is some communication from a naked singularity to an observer. Okay. Now, this model, you can say, look, it's not good. I wish it wasn't there. But at least it's all behind the horizon. Right? And maybe I can just save general relativity by saying, I will never look beyond the horizon. I'll just focus here. Here, there's no problem. There's no naked singularity. It's all there behind the horizon. Strong cosmic censorship says, nowhere should you have any signals from the naked singularity. And that is clearly violated. Right? This model violates it pretty straightforwardly. So maybe we need a weak cosmic censorship, which says, I don't care what happens behind the horizon, but at least outside the horizon, life should be all right, everything should be pretty good. Now, Penrose himself has said, this is probably not such a sensible idea. So I've got a nice quote from him here. It seems to be quite unreasonable to suppose that the physics in a comparatively local region of space-time should really care whether a light ray setting out from the singularity should ultimately escape to infinity or not. Right, that's the point here. So if I go here, there is a light ray from the naked singularity that's coming out. It doesn't reach infinity. It falls back on the singularity. But it did come out, and I can do experiments here. Penrose says that's bad enough. Unpredictability entailed by the presence of a naked singularity, which is so abhorrent to many people, I think he means physicists, would be present just as much for this local observer as for an observer at infinity. So, on a very kind of high level, Penrose says any naked singularity is bad because it means that there are regions where you can get unpredictable signals. But nevertheless, he has also himself suggested maybe, you know, we should weaken our censorship and go for a weak cosmic censorship, where you basically say, you cannot have naked singularities which are visible outside horizons. Inside, we know it will probably happen again. It's all. At least outside, we should be safe. Problem is, this is also violated. Because there are clear counterexamples. One somewhat crazy counterexample is the superspinning curve. If you just take the curve metric and put A greater than M, you get a metric. And it's got a naked singularity, it doesn't have a horizon. It's a naked singularity which can communicate with the whole universe. This is very artificial because nobody knows how to make a curve with A greater than M. And there's no way you can start with a normal curl black hole, spin it up here. So you just have to create it out of nowhere, and nobody knows how to do it. So I would say, even though this solution exists and it violates weak cosmic censorship, let's not worry about it. This is the one I think we should worry about. The same Oppenheimer-Snyder with this peak density, right? There is an extra parameter, how much you curve this density, or rather how far out you put your boundary. So it turns out, the diagram I showed was only for half the models. This one, where the naked singularity is behind the horizon, is for half the models. You tune your parameter, this curvature, you get a different kind of a case, where this is what it looks like. It's again a centrally peaked curve, it's just a different choice of parameters. The singularity forms, and the horizon also forms at the same time. So it's not like the horizon formed first. In this particular geometry, everything happens at this one point. There is a naked singularity here. This naked singularity can radiate. Some of the radiation will go and fall back on the singularity, but some of the radiation can escape from the field. So in terms of a Penrose diagram, this is what it looks like. There's your space like, ultimately this is your Schwarzschild black hole. Space-like singularity. But at this collapse tip, when your naked singularity is formed, there is this null singular line, and in this particular case, this null line sticks outside the horizon. This is the horizon. This whole region inside the horizon is able to see the naked singularity, and what is worse, there are regions outside that can also see the naked singularity. So you know, you could go here, get some signals from this naked singularity, and then escape to infinity and spread the news to everyone, you know, what goes on in naked singularity. This is terrible, because this really violates weak cosmic censorship. This is a globally visible naked singularity. This, I think, is the one to really worry about. But if you ask the people who worry about these things, they'll say, don't worry, we are still okay. We are maybe still okay. What's the excuse? All of these examples are highly symmetric points, right? Everything was either spherically symmetric, they're all spherically symmetric. Curl is axisymmetric, and as far as I know, that pretty much wraps up all the solutions people know. I don't think there's any real three-dimensional naked singularity model. So the story here is, fine, we have got models that produce naked singularities. They may even be visible outside the horizon, but they're so special. Can you show me that if I make arbitrary perturbations to initial conditions, not special perturbation, not spherically symmetric, but arbitrary three-dimensional perturbations, will it still form a naked singularity? How do I know? Maybe it's not. In other words, maybe we are all, you know, playing these beautiful games with things that we can solve analytically, but all of these models may be a set of measure zero, and the real models that we care about, the generic models that start from generic conditions, maybe by magic they will never have a naked singularity. Maybe even strong cosmic censorship is satisfied, and very likely weak is satisfied. So, this is the story. Generic spacetimes may be still safe. This is an open question, it's not being proved. There are two approaches, and I presume mathematicians are doing this. One approach is just like the singularity theorems of Penrose and Hawking, who showed, if you give me a trapped surface, the horizon, then I can prove that there has to be a singularity in the interior, in the future of that spacetime. An equivalent statement which can show that such and such generic initial conditions will definitely make naked singularity in the future of space-time, that's not being proved. Alternate is to just find one counterexample, right? But this has to be not a symmetric counterexample, a counterexample with enough generic parameters, and to show that that whole generic family of models will end up as naked singularities, that will disprove the whole thing. This is where it is. All the counterexamples so far are isometry counterexamples. Okay, so now let me go to the final little bit, and then I'll stop because I think it's not heavy stuff. So this Joshi Dwivedi collapse that I've been talking about, this is these clouds with a central peak in the density. They make naked singularities, but crudely speaking, they are naked flashes. And if you look at this, the naked singularity is just here. It's true that whatever this little point can radiate, some of it can reach infinity. So in fact, signals from here could reach all north of space-time out here. But still, in some real sense, this is one space-time point or rather, one null line in the Penrose diagram. And who knows how much stuff will come out. In astronomy, at least, you know, we like to look at things that live for a while and then we can study it. We could look at it today and come back tomorrow and 3 years later. And we would hope that it's the same object. It's not clear that a flash like this, we can study in that fashion. We either see it when it comes or it's gone. So that's not so good for observational work. You know, even if such naked singularities are formed in the universe, we as astronomers at least are not going to be able to see it. Unless it has some consequences which we can then observe. Say a supernova explosion does something different because of a naked singularity in the middle, that could be interesting. But direct signals will be hard. So you can ask, can you have a long-lived naked singularity? Some guy that forms and just sits there, waits for you to get your act together and make measurements, and then go and verify it and see what kind of signals it produces. Yes, but these are really artificial examples. So there, you know, we came up with a set of artificial models where you start with, again, a cloud, but now this is a differently tuned cloud. This is not dust, it also has some pressure. And by setting up conditions, in the initial conditions and making it spherical, you can actually produce a collapse, finely tuned, but it's a collapse that asymptotically becomes singular. Okay, so the center will go to infinite density. It will develop some kind of a power law, density profile with radius. Redshift will be infinity at the center. Curvature will be infinity at the center. And this guy will just sit there on this naked model forever and forever. So the longer you wait, the more nearly perfectly naked singular it is. So that, I think, is about the closest you can get to a long-lived, globally visible naked singularity. You can make these guys. They are horribly tuned. They are terribly unstable, not in the, they're also in the mathematician sense, but they're unstable physically. This shit may do something different. They're not going to stay there. But it's a nice mathematical model. So I've already said that. It's just basically collapse of a cloud with some equation of state, and you can choose your equation of state, and you can tune parameters and make it work. And the end state is a static timeline naked singularity, which has just a couple of parameters. You have a mass n, and you have a radius, an outer radius. So this is some material that has some distribution, an outer radius. Beyond it is Schwarzschild. Inside it is this funny material, which has its own metric. You can solve for the metric, of course. I don't think anybody's interested. This is the metric. Basically, it's got two parameters. It's got a mass and the radius. And really, it's only one parameter. There's one number which tells you how compact this model is. This is the one there. It's kind of almost obvious. 2m over r boundary. So this guy will be 1 for a Schwarzschild black hole. If you set r equal to the horizon radius, this is 1. So this guy, the naked singularity is a little bigger than the Schwarzschild black hole. And depending on how much bigger it is, you can talk about a compactness. It gets less and less compact as you go on. Okay, so suppose the universe had one of these guys. And I'm not holding my breath for people to find it, because as I said, it's so fine-tuned. It's not in, this one is not going to happen. But still, it's a model that we can study. So that's the spirit in which one should look at it. If you had this model and you had accretion, what would you observe? So this is a question you can ask. And since I'm here at the VHI, I was thinking in terms of what the image would look like, right? If I had an accretion flow around this one of these JM and spacetimes, and it produced radiation, and I went to the EHT, Event Horizon Telescope, and looked at the image, what would it look like? Everybody here knows about the EHT, I presume. Shep Bollman here. It's the big boss. Some other big bosses, and lots of people, several here in the audience, who are all helping to make this thing a success. So this is a global project which uses telescopes distributed all over the world, all the way from the South Pole to Greenland and Hawaii and Europe and Mexico and Chile and a whole lot of them. These are all telescopes that will simultaneously observe some distant black hole. But the primary target is the black hole in the center of our galaxy, Sagittarius A star. And then with some very fancy processing and all that, one hopes to get an image out of this, these measurements. So the idea is to get an actual picture of the accretion flow around Sagittarius A star with enough resolution to see stuff on the scale of the horizon, so right near the center. This is my day job, okay? Advising Andrew, showing him how to run simulations. So he shows me how to do it. But basically, this is Andrew's simulation, one simulation of many, of gas accreting on Sagittarius A star, producing submillimeter radiation. If you had a perfect camera and a perfect time resolution, and you could make a movie, we think this is roughly what it should look. The real telescope is not going to have all this detailed angular resolution, nor is it going to have, at least to start with, time resolution. You will get some average image, averaged over hours or even days. And the main point in this picture is to notice that there is one circular feature here. It kind of stays there, regardless of what the gas is. The gas is highly turbulent, it's doing all sorts of crazy things. But there's one feature, a ring. This is the primary goal of the EHT. You see this ring, because this ring has nothing to do with the details of the accretion. It's purely a signature of the metric, just the space-time in the black hole, near the black hole, with gravitational deflection gives you a ring here. This is what we are all trying to observe and verify, and you know exactly what size it should have. So then you can ask, what would this thing look like if I had a naked simulator of that form, you know, that artificial model that I talked about. So, the next slide will show you some of the results. Here is a toy accretion model on a short-shaped black hole. So this is supposed to be the galactic center. I've got a 4 times 10 to the 6 solar mass black hole, and I'm considering spherical accretion. So I'm just having gas, hot gas, just flowing in spherically. It gets hot as it comes to the center, it radiates. And this is what the image in this model would look like for the EHT. Okay? This is a millimeter wave, 230 gigahertz image of spherical so-called Bondi accretion on the galactic center. And you see this famous ring. This is a signature, as I said. You're going to see it, whatever the details of the accretion. So there's a nice thin ring. This is the so-called shadow of the black hole. Great. What would the naked singularity look like? Depends on which model you choose. As I told you, there is this compactness parameter. So for certain compactnesses, it looks identical. This is a naked singularity, space-time. Same Bondi accretion solved on this other space-time with the same equations and the same radiative transfer. This is what you would see versus this is what the Schwarzschild black hole will get. Some other compactness you use, this is what you will see. My co-author calls it the full moon image. This is a shadow, this is a full moon. So you get a full moon image, ignore this little dot in the middle, that's just a numerical artifact. It's all white in the middle. It just shows that you can have compact objects and compact objects, and some will look a lot like black holes, and some will look completely different, no ring at all. You're just basically seeing radiation from this entire accretion flow going down to the center r equal to 0. What this means, I don't know. It just shows that, you know, there is more to imaging and life than one might have thought just by looking at black holes. I won't even talk about this slide. You can do other kinds of models where you look at the standard thin accretion disk. You can calculate spectra. And the bottom line is very simple. The spectrum for a disk around a naked singularity model would look different from a disk around a Schwarzschild black hole. The Schwarzschild black hole, the disk terminates at the ISCO. It has certain prediction. The naked singularity guy, the disk can go all the way down to r equal to 0. It produces radiation everywhere. And the spectrum will look different. Let's not go into the details. So I think we have reaching the end of the hour. So I'll just close with a summary. So the first part, I think this is fairly solid. We have tons of black hole candidates in the universe. And within the limitations of astronomical observations, I think we have tons of evidence that they have horizons. If they don't have horizons, they have to be very peculiar. Of course, they could be extremely high redshift, or they could have some crazy surface, which is not like anything we're familiar with. But basically, a large variety of models without a horizon can be ruled out. This is an open area. The possibility of naked singularities. It's easy to come up with models which satisfy GR and all sorts of good physical constraints which produce naked singularities. Okay? That is not hard. You can make these models. And you can make models that violate strong cosmic censorship, weak cosmic censorship, etc. But it still leaves open the question whether these are generic models or only very special models. And also leaves open the question whether the real universe, our universe, with whatever physics is, has decided to follow, whether it has naked singularities or not. This, I think, is an open question. I would be very interested to find astronomical observations that can tell this guy's naked singularity. That's still a little difficult. You can do it for toy models, but these toy models are so unlikely, you should take them too seriously. We need naked singularity models that are stable. Stable physically and stable mathematically, in the sense forming from generic conditions. Then we can really, I think, explore how to find them and how to identify them through observations. So that's where we are. Thank you.
Any questions?
So a naive question, at least for mathematicians. What's the connection between weak gravity conjecture and cosmic sensing?
Weak energy or weak gravity?
Weak gravity.
I don't know what weak gravity conjecture is.
The one that any consistent quantum gravity theory should have a stable object with mass divided by electric charge less than 1.
Oh. Mass divided by electric charge less than 1. Okay. That is getting into quantum gravity regime.
So I'm asking, basically, I don't know what it is, but
I've
heard that this somehow implies that cosmic censorship is actually true.
Okay, so I think there is one escape route that everybody always mentions. Everything I said was based on classical GR, right? So the classical GR equations may give you singularities, and then you just say, but we don't have quantum gravity yet. Wait until we get quantum gravity to solve all the problems. You know, there will be no singularity. There will be something fuzzy in the middle, which will satisfy quantum laws. Nothing very strange. I don't know if that is true or not, since we don't have that theory. So, you know, the limit you're talking about is just the opposite of Reissner-Nordström, right? Reissner-Nordström Q is less than M. And you can write classical solutions. And you're talking now about particles that have the opposite limit. That, for the classical regime, that would be considered a very unphysical, because you can't make it. You can't take a Q less than M Reissner-Nordström black hole and keep adding charge and make it Q greater than M. You cannot do it. Just like you cannot get curved with A greater than M. But if quantum mechanically a particle can form with that regime, sure. But that is beyond the reach of these theories. Yeah.
You mentioned having astronomical observations to corroborate some of the stuff. Is it, and maybe they're quite difficult to make, is it possible to repass all these ideas in some analog theory of gravity to maybe it's more tabletop or it's more friendly to do experiments or making observations? Something like acoustic geometry or something like this, is it possible?
That's a very good point. Yeah, people have certainly made horizons with tabletop experiments. They're asking whether we can make a naked singularity with tabletop experiment. One thing is, these are all spherical models. The usual tabletop experiments, I think they're all plane waves and the horizon, but I may be wrong on that. We need to have a spherical system that makes, it's a great question. You should really think about that. Maybe, you know, this bathtub experiment where people have fluid going in and becoming supersonic. So maybe a two-dimensional model, can we have a collapse that is just nakedly singular? It will be a flash, however. So finding the signal may be tough. Very good. I've never thought about it. And nobody has mentioned the possibility so far as I know.
So if the known physics break down in naked singularity, how do you simulate in the last slide what we should look? What should look?
So the calculations we did, we took the naked singularity solution, which has got whatever metric.
Yeah.
I know what you're asking, I think. So you're saying right at r equal to 0, everything breaks down. So what did I do? Calculate the spectrum. Is that the question you asked? Or?
Yeah, you showed a graph where the naked singularity, you compare the horizon, what the horizon would look like with what the naked singularity should look like.
Right.
How do you produce that image?
That image was produced by just taking the same accretion flow, sending the gas right down to r equal to 0. The property of all of these space times is, by the time material reaches r equal to 0, it has zero mass. So it has lost all of its rest mass energy by the time it comes down to the center. So there's nothing left. It pretty much lost 100% of its rest mass energy to radiation by the time it reached the center. So therefore, at least in our calculations, we decided it doesn't matter what boundary condition you put in the middle. All we said was there is no extra signal coming out from the naked singularity. That was an assumption. That's a boundary condition. So the boundary condition was only stuff can fall in, nothing comes out. So it's almost like a black hole, except that the condition is put at r equal to 0, not at the horizon. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? All right, not this, thanks.
Yeah,
okay.
That's more important.
Yeah.
This is my.